Thank you very much, and thanks to all the organizers for the invitation to this conference. So what I'm going to present is a joint work with Adrian Rogers from Bernoulli Institute in Groningen. It's a work that we did a bit more than a year ago. It's about semi-definite programs. So let's consider a general semi-definite program. We have an unknown matrix X. So we want to find this unknown matrix X. We want it to minimize the trace of Cx for some fixed and known cost matrix C under two types of constraints. So X must satisfy affine constraints, M affine constraints represented by the equality A of X equals B, where A is a linear operator with a range included in Rm. And also we want X to be a semi-definite positive. So these semi-definite programs, they arise in particular as relaxations from combinatorial optimization problems. It has been known for quite a while now that there are many difficult optimization problems which you can lift, so approximate in some sense, by semi-definite programs, and oftentimes although the semi-definite program is a priori only an approximation of the initial problem, it turns out that when you solve the semi-definite program, you get the exact solution of the difficult problem that you've started from. And in particular, this lifting procedure appears when you want to solve max-cut problems. So I mention it here because it's a family of semi-definite programs which I will use as an example, as an illustration at the end of the talk. So I prefer to introduce it now. So max-cut problems are originally problems from graph theory. You take a graph and you want to partition its vertices into two sets, so that the number of edges that you cut when you do the partition is maximal. And it turns out that you can approximate maximum cut problems by semi-definite programs of the form written here. So of the form minimize the trace of Cx for some cost matrix C under the constraint that the diagonal of X contains only the number one. And also under the constraint, of course, that X is semi-definite positive. There has been a lot of research into algorithms which can solve semi-definite problems. So there are several semi-definite problem solvers which work in polynomial time. So if you fix a precision, you can solve your semi-definite program in polynomial time, depending on the precision. However, these problems, these solvers, although polynomial, tend to be slow because the order of the involved polynomial function is large. So, for instance, if you use interior point solvers, then in full generality, the per iteration complexity is of the order of n4, where n is the size of the unknown matrix. So of course you imagine that you cannot work with very large values of n. Other algorithms that than interior point solvers are possible, but they tend to suffer from more or less the same drawback. So if you still want to solve high dimensional semi-definite programs, you have to exploit the fact that the problems that you consider are not generic. They may have favorable properties that you can use. In particular, oftentimes, the semi-definite programs that we are interested in, they have a solution with low rank. So actually, for geometric reasons, semi-definite programs always have a solution with rank at most this number, so it's of the order of square root of 2m. I recall you that m is a number of affine constraints. In many situations, because of the way that the semi-definite program has been constructed, in particular through lifting from a combinatorial optimization problem, there is often a solution with rank 1 or 2. So very small. And to exploit the fact that there is a solution with low rank, there are two main families of methods. One of them is Frank-Wolf methods, and the other one is the Buhr-Montero heuristic. Both of them are interesting, but in this talk I will focus only on the Buhr-Montero factorization. So let me explain how it works. So since there is a we assume that there is a solution with low rank, so we call R opt the rank of a low rank solution, and we observe that the solution then can be written as X equals VV transpose for a matrix V with n rows and p columns for any integer p, which is at least as large as the optimal rank. And so it means that we can write the unknown matrix X under the form VV transpose, and instead of directly trying to recover X, so to optimize over X, we can try to optimize over V. This change of variables transforms our general semi-definite problem at the top of the page into the second problem, where we want now to minimize the trace of C VV transpose over all matrices V which satisfy the condition A of VV transpose equals B. You note that the semi-definite positiveness constraint has disappeared because matrices of the form VV transpose are always semi-definite positive. I'd like to emphasize the fact that P, the integer P, is a factorization rank, so it's called the factorization rank, and it's a parameter of the factorization. It's something that must be chosen. It can be equal to R opt, it can be larger, and whether you choose it equal or larger or much larger will have will be important for the properties of the factorized problem that you get. So one choice or another may make this problem easier or more difficult to solve. So it's an important choice. So now let's consider the factorized problem. And let's assume that the set of feasible matrices V, so the set of matrices V satisfying the constraint A of VV transpose equals B, is a manifold, and it's a nice manifold in the sense that we know it explicitly, we can manipulate it, and in particular we can run Riemannian optimization algorithms over this manifold. So in this setting, well, we can precisely try to minimize the trace of CVV transpose by Riemannian optimization over the manifold of feasible points, and then the number of variables that we have to optimize during this process, it's not n square anymore, as in the non-factorized formulation, it's n times p, the number of coefficients in V, and since p can be much smaller than n, we have much less coefficients to find, so we can hope for Riemannian algorithms to be much faster than SDP solvers. However, there is one issue, it's that the factorized problem, it's not convex anymore. On the contrary to the semi-definite program, which we had at the beginning. In particular, it might happen that Riemannian optimization algorithms get stuck at a local minimum or critical point instead of finding the global minimizer of the problem. It's an issue that which can arise or cannot arise, and it depends on the choice of the factorization rank P. Therefore, I want to study the question, how must we choose P so that it's possible to solve the factorized problem without getting stuck at critical points? To give a partial answer to this question, I will first start with a literature review. We'll see that empirical observations tend to suggest that as soon as P is of the order slightly larger than the optimal rank, then Riemannian optimization algorithms work. They do not get stuck at critical points. And this phenomenon has been theoretically explained in very specific situations, but not in a general setting. In a general setting, so with no strong assumptions on the cost matrix C, the only guarantee that we have require the factorization rank P to be of the order of square root of 2m, where m, again, is a number of constraints. And since the optimal rank is generally much smaller than square root of 2m, there is a big gap between practice and general theory. So then we'll try to determine whether this gap is a theoretical artifact or not. And we'll see that it's possible to very slightly improve the general guarantees in the literature. But this improvement is very minor. It doesn't change the leading order square root of 2m. And with this improvement, the general guarantees are optimal in the sense that if p is smaller than square root of 2m, then the guarantees do not hold without additional assumptions on the cost matrix C. It's not possible to guarantee that Riemannian optimization algorithms will work and not get stuck at critical points. So this will be the main results of the talk, and I try to give a brief overview of the proof. And finally, I will try to describe two open questions. So let's start with the literature. So the Bure-Montero heuristic has been introduced by Bure and Montero in 2003. And in the article where they introduced their heuristic, Bure and Montero performed a lot of numerical experiments on various semi-definite programs. They used only a factorization rank P of the order of square root of 2m. They did not try smaller values of P. But at least for P equals square root of 2m, they observed that Riemannian optimization algorithms worked all the time. Other experiments can be found in an article by Journet, Bach, Absil and Sepulcre from 2010, which contains numerical experiments, notably on max cut relaxations. So these experiments are conducted with a specific initialization scheme, but at least with this scheme, the authors observed that Riemannian optimization algorithms always worked when P was exactly equal to the optimal rank. So, in principle, very small. And yet, another set of experiments has been done by Nicolas Boumal with problems coming from arising as relaxations of so-called orthogonal synchronization problems. And in this set of problems, the optimal rank is exactly 3 by construction. And Nicolas Boumal observed that Riemannian optimization algorithms always worked as soon as the factorization rank P was larger than 5. So strictly larger than the optimal rank, but not much larger. And similar observations have been made for variants of SDP problems, which I will not describe. So This phenomenon has been theoretically rigorously explained in a specific, very specific setting by Bandera, Boumal, and Voroninsky in 2016. So the authors, they considered semi-definite problems arising as obtained by lifting optimization problems called Z2 synchronization or community detection. They made very strong assumptions on the statistical properties of the underlying Z2 synchronization and community detection problems. Thanks to these strong assumptions, the resulting semi-definite programs had a lot of structure, and this allowed them to show that with high probability, the semi-definite problems they considered had rank one, and the Bure-Montero factorization with factorization rank p equal 2 was such that Riemannian optimization algorithms could not fail. So in this specific case, the success of Riemannian optimization algorithms was explained, but it's quite a complicated proof, and it's only for a very specific setting. For variants of semi-definite programs, other very specific settings could be studied and similar results could be obtained. But all the time, the principle is the same. You need very strong assumptions on the problem that you consider. And then with these strong assumptions, you can show that if the factorization rank P is larger than the optimal rank, then everything works. And if you don't want to have to do very strong assumptions on the semi-definite program that you consider, then the literature does not contain many results about this. There is essentially one result. It's again due to Boumal, Voroninsky, and Bandera. So I will describe this result. Let me first recall the problem that we are considering. So it's a factorized semi-definite program. We want to minimize the trace of CV V transpose over the matrices V for which A of V V transpose is equal to B. We denote by MP the set of feasible matrices V, and we assume that this set is a manifold. Actually, Boumal, Voroninsky, and Bandera need a slightly stronger assumption, but in practice, it's essentially equivalent to the fact that this set is a manifold. So the problem that we consider can be equivalently rewritten as minimize the trace of CVV transpose over all matrices V in MP. And Boumal, Voroninsky, and Bandera observe that Riemannian optimization algorithms, at least suitable Riemannian optimization algorithms, when properly implemented, they necessarily converge to a second-order critical point, meaning that they converge to a point, to a matrix V0 in MP, which satisfies first-order conditions. So the gradient at V0 of the cost function is zero, and which also satisfies second-order conditions, meaning that the Hessian of the cost function at V0 is semi-definite positive. And the authors showed that for almost all cost matrices C, provided that the factorization rank P was larger than square root of 2m plus 1/4 minus 1/2, then all second order critical points were global minimizers. As a consequence, since Riemannian optimization algorithms find at least one second order critical point, well, they necessarily find a global minimizer. So this proves that Riemannian optimization algorithms necessarily succeed in finding the global solution, provided that P is larger than this number, which is essentially square root of 2m. you observe that the lower bound on P in the theorem does not depend on the optimal rank. It's of the order of square root of 2m, whether the optimal rank is large or very small. So to summarize what I've said so far, from numerical experiments, it seems that Riemannian optimization algorithms work well as soon as the factorization rank P is of the order of the optimal rank. But the only theoretical general guarantees that we have to justify this fact require the factorization rank P to be at least as large as square root of 2m. Yes.
Can you explain what do you mean by almost all C in the previous
term? Yes, sorry, I haven't said it. Almost all C means all matrices C minus a set with zero Lebesgue measure. So it's in the Lebesgue measure sense. And as I've already said several times, the optimal rank is generally much smaller than square root of 2m, and hence there is a gap between these two regimes. So now we are going to try to answer the question, is it possible to obtain general guarantees for values of p much smaller than square root of 2m? And we are going to see that we can slightly improve the lower bound on P on the theorem by Boumal, Voroninsky, and Bandera. But it's really a slight improvement. It will not change the fact that this bound is of the order of square root of 2m up to constants. With this improvement, the result is essentially optimal, in the sense that even if you assume that the optimal rank is 1, so the smallest you can hope for, then if even in this situation, if P is smaller than square root of 2m, there are situations, there are bad cost matrices C for which it's possible that Riemannian optimization algorithms fail. So first, the slight improvement over the result by Boumal, Voroninsky, and Bandera. So we can have the same theorem as theirs, replacing their lower bound by square root of 2m plus 9 fourths minus 3 halves. So you can check that this lower bound is strictly better than the one in Boumal, Voroninsky, and Bandera. But generally, the two upper bounds, the lower bounds, they differ only by one unit, meaning that unless m is very small, it's not very interesting. And with this improvement, the theorem is essentially optimal. So let's describe why. So we define R0 to be the minimal rank of a matrix X in the feasible set of the original semi-definite program. So this is a line at the top. And then on the suitable hypothesis, so technical hypothesis that, which I will not describe, but which are generically satisfied. As soon as the factorization rank P is smaller than this number, which is of the order of square root of 2m, there exists a set of bad cost matrices C for which the corresponding semi-definite program has an optimal solution with rank R0. And nevertheless, the Bure-Montero factorization has a second order critical point, which is not a global minimizer. Meaning that if you try to run a Riemannian optimization algorithm and you're unlucky enough to initialize it close to a second order critical point, which is not a global minimizer, then this algorithm will fail. So in this theorem, I have a number R0. In most applications of interest, R0 is really small. You can even, so in many applications, actually R0 is 1. So this yields the following picture. When the factorization rank P is larger than square root of 2m plus 9 fourths minus 3 halves, then Riemannian optimization algorithms work for almost all matrices C. When the factorization rank P is smaller than this number, then you cannot rule out the possibility that Riemannian optimization algorithms fail. And in between, we don't know what happens, but the in between has only size R0 minus 1, so it's typically much smaller than square root of 2m, and if R0 is equal to 1, it's even 0. We can apply this result to max-cut problems, as I've described in the introduction. So I recall that max-cut relaxations are semi-definite problems of the form at the top, so you want to minimize the trace of Cx under the constraint that the diagonal of x is 1 and x is semi-definite positive. When we relax it, so when we factorize it through the Bure-Montero heuristic, we get the problem minimize the trace of CVV transpose under the constraint that the diagonal of VV transpose is 1. And in this case, we can check that R0 equals 1 and the technical hypotheses that I've mentioned are satisfied. Therefore, for problems of this type, if the factorization rank P is larger than the number at the top, then Riemannian optimization algorithms always work for almost all cost matrices C. But if P is smaller than this quantity, then there are matrices C in a non-zero Lebesgue measure set for which, even if we assume that there is a rank 1 solution, so much smaller than square root of 2m, there are bad second-order critical points and Riemannian algorithms can fail. So I'm now turning to the proof. Do you have questions now, before I begin the proof? Yes? Is R0 the solution to the whole SVP, or is it... So in my theorem, I consider a family of semi-definite problems. I consider... I fix A, I consider the operator A, which defines the affine constraints, is fixed, but I consider all possible cost matrices C, so there is not one global solution. So R0 is the minimal possible rank for the solution when I look at all possible cost matrices C.
So if you consider the set of C of matrices C for which the rank is equal to 1, the rank of the best solution of your SVP, will this set be of zero Lebesgue measure or not necessarily?
No, it's not.
It's not.
No. No, it's not, and yeah, actually it's also a consequence of the theorem, although it's not formulated that way. If you forget the second property, then you see that there is a non-zero Lebesgue measure set on which the global minimizer necessarily has rank R0. Okay, so let's start with the proof. So we assume that the factorization rank P is smaller than square root of 2m plus this. And we want to show that Riemannian optimization algorithms can fail. So we want to show that it's possible to construct a set of cost matrices C with non-zero Lebesgue measure on which the global minimizer has rank R0. And for any cost matrix C in this set, there is, so the factorized problem has a second order critical point, which is not a global solution. This is done in two steps. First, we construct one matrix C which satisfies these two properties. And second, we show that all cost matrices close enough to this bad C satisfy the same properties. Hence, there is a small ball of cost matrices C satisfying these properties. Hence, there is a non-zero Lebesgue measure set of matrices satisfying these properties. The second step is very classical. So it uses only classical arguments. I will therefore focus only on the first step. So I will try to explain how it's possible to construct one bad cost matrix C. So let's fix x0 with rank r0 in the feasible set of the semi-definite problem. And let's fix v in the feasible set of the factorized problem. And we are going to construct a cost matrix C for which the semi-definite problem has x0 as a global minimizer. And the factorized problem has v as a second order critical point, which is not a global solution. So if we construct such a C, then we have constructed a C satisfying the two properties that we want. So the global minimizer has rank R0, and there is a second order critical point of the factorized problem, which is not optimal. So it turns out that constructing such a matrix C is actually possible for almost any choices of x0 and v. So let's fix arbitrary x0 and v and construct C. So we want C to have x0 as the unique global minimizer of the semi-definite problem, and we want the factorized problem associated with C to have v as a second order critical point. Since we know the analytic expressions of the gradient and the Hessian of all the functions involved, we can rewrite these two conditions under explicit analytic forms, and we can simplify the expressions that we get, and we can show, trust me about this, it's not obvious, but we can show that the construction of C is possible as soon as there exists a vector mu in Rm for which V transpose A star mu V is semi-definite positive and X0 transpose A star mu V is zero, where A star is the adjoint operator to A, of A. So we wonder whether there exists such a mu. And to determine whether it exists or not, we consider the map, the following map, so from Rm to the product of the symmetric matrices with size M, P by P, and the matrices with size R0 by P, the map which to mu associates V transpose A star mu V, X0 transpose A star mu V. And we compute the dimension of Rm and the image set, so the symmetric matrices times the R0 by P matrices. And we observe that if the dimension of Rm is larger than the dimension of the image set, so P plus 1 over 2 plus P times R0, then the map that I've just defined should generically be surjective. You consider a more or less arbitrary map between a vector space and a vector space with smaller dimension. It's generically surjective. And if the map is surjective, it's possible to find mu such that the two conditions above are satisfied. You can do this by choosing mu for which the image of mu by the map is the identity product with zero. And the condition that m is larger than pp plus 1 over 2 plus pr0 is exactly equivalent to the condition that we have imposed on p at the beginning of the proof. Hence, the map which I've defined is generically surjective, and mu generically exists, and because we have technical assumptions which I've hidden into the carpet, under the carpet, actually it's not generically surjective, it's surjective. So let's summarize. When P is larger than square root of 2m, Boumal, Voroninsky, and Bandera have shown that for almost any cost matrix, the factorized problem has no second order critical points which are not minimizer, and hence the factorized problem can be solved efficiently. And numerical experiments suggested that maybe we could conjecture that this was also true for p of the order of the optimal rank, so smaller than square root of 2m. And what we've proved with Alan Waters is that when p is smaller than square root of 2m, no, actually it's not true. If we want to guarantee that Riemannian optimization algorithms work, we need to use some additional assumptions on c. It's not true for any c. There are two open questions which I would like to briefly describe. So the two main open questions which I'm interested in are, first, to better understand the regime where p is smaller than square root of 2m, and second, to see how the Bureau-Montero technique applies to phase retrieval problems, so a specific family of semi-definite problems. So for the first question, actually the theoretical guarantees which now exist in the literature about solving the Bureau-Montero factorization, these results, they are of two types. So either you have articles which assume very strong assumptions on the cost matrix, so on the problem, and they get very strong conclusions. You can show that there are no bad critical points for p of the order of the optimal rank, so the optimal rank or the optimal rank plus one. So when the cost matrix C is very nice, in some sense, you can say that the factorization works for p of the order of the optimal rank. And what we've shown with Alan Waters could be summarized by the sentence, but if we allow C to be arbitrarily adversarial, then it's necessary to take p of the order of square root of 2m. Otherwise, we may get stuck into critical points. But in most applications, I think the cost matrices C, they are neither very nice, neither very bad. So we'd like to understand the regime in between. So it would be interesting to get results like, if we have like reasonable but not very strong assumptions on C, then the Bureau-Montero factorization has no second order critical points for p of the order of the optimal rank, so not exactly the optimal rank, but something like maybe twice or three times the optimal rank. So this is something that I think would be useful. And the second question, which I'm interested in, is to see what the theoretical insights, which I've tried to describe, can apply and be potentially useful in a specific application. So I'm personally interested in phase retrieval problems, which are problems arising notably in optics, where you try to reconstruct a vector x with complex coordinates from the modulus, the standard complex modulus, of linear measurements. These problems, it's known that they can be approximated with semi-definite problems. And when we solve the corresponding semi-definite problems, we get phase retrieval algorithms, which are usually very precise, but which do not really work in high dimension because solving semi-definite programs is usually costly. And so I would be interested in understanding to what extent the Bureau-Montero heuristic can speed up the solving of semi-definite problems coming from phase retrieval. It's something that has been tried before, but I think there are questions which have not been looked at with maybe enough care. In particular, understanding which factorization rank we must choose. I think in the case of phase retrieval, it's both a subtle and important question. And okay, so I think this question is interesting. And with that, I'm going to thank you for your attention.